Chapter 1 of Rip Foster Rides the Gray Planet by Harold Goodwin. Rip Foster Rides the Gray Planet. Chapter 1 SCN Scorpius, Spacebound. 1,000 miles above the Earth's surface, the great space platform sped from daylight into darkness. Once every 2 hours it circled the Earth completely, spinning along through space like a mighty wheel of steel and plastic. Through a telescope on Earth, the platform looked to be a lifeless, lonely disk, but within it hundreds of spacemen and planeteers went about their work. In a ready room at the outer edge of the platform, a planeteer officer faced a dozen slim, black-clad young men who wore the single golden orbits of lieutenants. This was a graduating class, already commissioned, having a final informal get-together. The officer, who wore the three-orbit insignia of a major, was lean and trim. His short-cropped hair covered his head like a gray fur skullcap. One cheek was marked with the crisp whiteness of an old radiation burn.
"Stand easy," he ordered briskly. "The general instructions of the Special Order Squadron say that it's my duty as senior officer to make a farewell speech. I intend to make a speech if it kills me, and you too."
The dozen new officers facing him broke into grins. Major Joe Barris had been their friend, teacher, and senior officer during 6 long years of training on the space platform. He could no more make a formal speech than he could breathe high vacuum, and they all knew it. Lieutenant Richard Ingalls Peter Foster, whose initials had given him the nickname Rip, asked, "Why don't you sing for us instead, Joe?" Major Barris fixed Rip with a cold eye.
"Foster, three orbital turns, then front and center."
Rip obediently spun around 3 times, then walked forward and stood at attention, trying to conceal his grin.
"Foster, what does SOS mean?"
"Special Order Squadron, sir."
"Right. And what else does it mean?"
"It means help, sir."
"Right. And what else does it mean?"
"Superman or simp, sir."
This was a ceremony in which questions and answers never changed. It was supposed to make Planeteer cadets and junior officers feel properly humble, but it didn't work. By tradition, the Planeteers were the cockiest gang that ever blasted through high vacuum. Major Barris shook his head sadly.
"You admit you're a simp, Foster. The rest of you are simps, too, but you don't believe it. You finished 6 years on the platform. You made a few little trips out into space. You've landed on the moon a couple of times, so now you think you're seasoned space spooks. Well, you're not. You're simps."
Rip stopped grinning. He had heard this before. It was part of the routine. But he sensed that this time Joe Barris wasn't kidding. The major absently rubbed the radiation scar on his cheek as he looked them over. They were like 12 chicks out of the same nest. They were about the same size, a compact 5 feet 11 inches, 175 pounds. They wore belted, loose black tunics over full trousers, which gathered into white cruiser boots. The comfortable uniforms concealed any slight differences in build. All 12 were lean of face, with hair cropped to the regulation half-inch. Rip was the only redhead among them.
"Sit down," Barris commanded. "Here's my speech."
The 12 seated themselves on plastic stools. Major Barris remained standing.
"Well," he began soberly, "you are now officers of the Special Order Squadrons. You are Planeteers. You are lieutenants by order of the Space Council, Federation of Free Governments. And, space protect you, to yourselves, you're supermen. But never forget this. To ordinary spacemen, you're just plain simps. You're trouble in a black tunic. They have about as much use for you as they have for leaks in their airlocks. Some of the spacemen have been high-vacking for 20 years or more, and they're tough. They're as nasty as a Callistan tecal. They like to eat Planeteer junior officers for breakfast."
Lieutenant Felipe Flip Villa asked,
"We assault, Joe?"
Major Barris sighed.
"No use trying to tell you space chicks anything. You're lieutenants now, and a lieutenant has the thickest skull of any rank, no matter what service he belongs to."
Rip realized that Barris had not been joking, no matter how flippant his speech.
"'Go ahead,' he urged. "'Finish what you were going to say.' "'Okay, I'll make it short. Then you can catch the Terra rocket and take your 8 weeks Earth leave. You won't really know what I'm talking about until you've batted around space for a while. All I have to say adds up to one thing. You won't like it because it doesn't sound scientific. That doesn't mean it isn't good science, because it is. Just remember this. When you're in a jam, trust your hunch and not your head."
The 12 stared at him open-mouthed. For 6 years they had been taught to rely on scientific methods. Now their best instructor and senior officer was telling them just the opposite. Rip started to object, but then he caught a glimmer of meaning. He stuck out his hand.
"'Thanks, Joe. I hope we'll meet again.'
Barris grinned.
"'We will, Rip. I'll ask for you as a platoon commander when they assign me to cleaning up the goopies on Ganymede.'
This was the Major's idea of the worst Planeteer job in the solar system. The group shook hands all around. Then the young officers broke for the door on the run. The Terra rocket was blasting off in 5 minutes, and they were to be on it. Rip joined Flip Via, and they jumped on the high-speed track that would whisk them to Valve 2 on the other side of the platform. Their gear was already loaded. They had only to take seats on the rocket, and their 6 years on the space platform would be at an end. "'I wonder what it will be like to get back to high gravity,' Rip mused. The centrifugal force of the spinning platform acted as artificial gravity, but it was considerably less than Earth's.
"'We probably won't be able to walk straight until we get our Earth legs back,' Flip answered. "'I wish I could stay in Colorado with you instead of going back to Mexico City, Rip. We could have a lot of fun in 8 weeks.'
Rip nodded. "'Tough luck, Flip. But anyway, we have the same assignment.' Both Planeteers had been assigned to Special Order Squadron 4, which was attached to the cruiser Bolide. The cruiser was in high space, beyond the orbits of Jupiter and Saturn, doing comet research. They got off the track at Valve 2 and stepped through into the rocket's interior. Two seats just ahead of the fins were vacant, and they slid into them. Rip looked through the thick port beside him and saw the distinctive blue glow of a nuclear drive cruiser sliding toward the platform.
"'Wave your ice dogs at that job,' Flip said admiringly. "'Wonder what it's doing here.'
The space platform was a refueling depot, where conventional chemical fuel rockets topped off their tanks before flaming for space. The newer nuclear drive cruisers had no need to stop. Their atomic piles needed new neutron sources only once every few years, and they carried thousands of tons of methane compressed into solid form for their reaction mass. The voice horn in the rocket cabin sounded.
"'The SCN Scorpius is passing Valve 2, landing at Valve 8.'
"'I thought that ship was with Squadron 1 on Mercury,' Rip recalled. "'Wonder why they pulled it back here?' Flip had no chance to reply, because the chief rocket officer took up his station at the valve and began to call the roll. Rip answered to his name. The rocket officer finished the roll, then announced,
"'Buttoning up in 20 seconds. Blast-off in 45. Don't bother with acceleration harness. We'll fall free with just enough flame going for control after 10 seconds of retrothrust to deorbit.'
The 10-second warning bell sounded, and before the bell had ceased, the voice horn blasted.
"'Get it! Foster R.I.P., Lieutenant. Report to the platform commander. Show an exhaust!'
Rip leapt to his feet. "'Hold on, Flip. I'll see what the old man wants and be right back.'
"'Get flaming!' the rocket officer called. "'Show an exhaust, like the man said. This bucket leaves on time, and we're sealing the port.'
Rip hesitated. The rocket would leave without him. Flip said urgently,
"'You'll better ram it, Rip.'
He knew he had no choice.
"'Tell my folks I'll make the next rocket,' he called and ran.
He leapt through the valve, jumped for the high-speed track, and was whisked around the rim of the space platform. He ran a hand through his short red hair, a gesture of bewilderment. His records had cleared. So far as he knew, all his papers were in order, and he had his next assignment. He couldn't figure why the platform commander would want to see him. But the horn had called, "Show an exhaust," which meant to get there in a hurry. He jumped off the track at the main cross-run, and hurried toward the center of the platform.
In a moment he was at the commander's door, waiting to be identified. The door swung open, and a junior officer in the blue tunic and trousers of a spaceman motioned him to the inner room.
"Go in, Lieutenant."
"Thank you." He hurried into the commander's room and stood at attention. Commander Jensen, the Norwegian spaceman who had commanded the platform since before Rip's arrival as a raw cadet, was dictating into his command relay circuit. As he spoke, printed copies were being received in the platform personnel office at Special Order Squadron headquarters on Earth, aboard the cruiser Bolide in high space, and aboard the newly landed cruiser Scorpius. Rip listened, spellbound.
"Foster, R.I.P., Lieutenant S.O.S., Serial 7943, assigned S.O.S.4, change orders effective this date time, cancel Earth leave. Subject officer will report to Commander S.C.N. Scorpius with detachment of 9 men. Senior non-commissioned officer and second-in-command, COA, AP, Sergeant Major, S.O.S., Serial 2941. Commander of Scorpius will transport detachment to coordinates given in basic cruiser astro course. Deliver orders to detachment en route. Take required steps for maximum security. This is Federation Priority A, Space Council Security Procedures."
Rip swallowed hard. The highest possible priority, given by the Federation itself, had canceled his leave. Not only that, but the cruiser to which he was assigned was instructed to follow Space Council security procedures, which meant that the job, whatever it was more urgent than secret. Commander Jensen looked up and saw Rip waiting. He snapped, "Did you get all of that?"
"Yes, sir."
"You'll get written copies on the cruiser. Now flame out of here. Collect your men and get aboard. The Scorpius leaves in 5 minutes." Rip ran. The realization hit him that the big nuclear cruiser had stopped at the platform for the sole purpose of collecting him and 9 enlisted Planeteers. The low gravity helped him cover the 100 yards to the personnel office in 5 leaps. He swung to a stop by grabbing the push bar of the office door. He yelled at the enlisted spaceman on duty,
"Where do I find 9 men?"
The spaceman looked at him vacantly.
"What for? You got a requisition, Lieutenant?"
"Never mind requisitions," Rip snapped. "I've got to find 9 Planeteers and get them on the Scorpius before it flames off." The spaceman's face cleared.
"Oh, you mean Koa's detachment. They left a few minutes ago."
"Where? Where did they go?"
The spaceman shrugged. The doings of Planeteers were no concern of his. His shrug said so.
Rip realized there was no use talking further. He ran down the long corridor toward the outer edge of the platform. The enlisted men's squad rooms were near Valve 10. So was the supply department. His gear had departed on the Terra rocket, and he couldn't go into space with only the tunic on his back. He swung to the high-speed track and braced himself as he sped along the platform's rim. There was no moving track inward to the enlisted Planeteer's squad rooms. He lugged it down the corridor in long leaps, muttering apologies as blue-clad spacemen and cadets moved to the wall to let him pass. The squad rooms were on 2 levels. He looked in the upper ones and found them deserted. The squads were on duty somewhere. He ran for the ladder to the lower level, took the wrong one, and ended up in a snapper boat port. He had trained in the deadly little fighting rockets, and they never failed to interest him. But there wasn't time to admire them now. He went back up the ladder with 2 strong heaves, found the right ladder, and dropped down without touching. His knees flexed to take up the shock. He came out of the crouch facing a black-clad Planeteer sergeant who snapped to rigid attention.
"Koa," Rip barked. "Where can I find him?"
"He's not here, sir. He and 8 men left 15 minutes ago. I don't know where they went, sir." Rip shot a worried glance at his wrist chronometer. He had 2 minutes left before the cruiser departed. No more time now to search for his men. He hoped the sergeant major had sense enough to be waiting at some reasonable place. He went up the ladder hand over hand and sped down the corridor to the supply room. The spaceman first class in charge of supplies was turning an audio mag through a hand viewer, chuckling at cartoons. At the sight of Rip's flushed, anxious face, he dropped the machine.
"Yes, sir?"
"I need a space pack. Full gear, including bubble."
"Yes, sir."
The spaceman looked him over with a practiced eye. "One full space pack. Medium large, right, sir?"
"Correct."
Rip took the counter stylus and inscribed his name, serial number, and signature on the blank plastic sheet. Gear's word as the data was recorded. The spaceman vanished into an inner room and reappeared in a moment lugging a plastic case called a space pack, or SPAC for short. It contained complete personal equipment for space travel. Rip grabbed it.
"Fast service. Thanks, Rocky."
All spacemen were called Rocky if you didn't know their names. It was an abbreviation for Rocketeer, a title all of them had once carried. Valve 8 was some distance away. Rip decided a cross-ramp would be faster than the moving track. He swung the SPAC to his shoulder and made his legs go. Seconds were ticking off, and he had an idea that the SCN Scorpius would make space on time, whether or not he arrived. He lengthened his stride and rounded a turn by going right up on the wall, using a powerful leg thrust against a ventilator tube for momentum. He passed an observation port as he reached the platform rim, and caught a glimpse of ruddy rocket exhaust flames outlined against the dark curve of Earth. That would be the Terra rocket making its controlled fall to home, with Flip aboard. Without slowing, he leapt across the high-speed track, narrowly missing a senior space officer. He shouted his apologies and gained the entrance to Valve 8, just as the high buzz of the radiation warning sounded, signaling a nuclear-drive cruiser preparing to take off. Nine faces of assorted colors and expressions turned to him. He had a quick impression of black tunics and trousers. He had found his detachment. Without slowing, he called, "Follow me!" The cruiser's safety officer had been keeping an eye on the clock, his forehead creased in a frown as he saw that only a few seconds remained to departure time. He walked to the valve opening and looked out. If his passengers were not in sight, he would have to reset the clock. Rip went through the valve opening at top speed. He crashed head-on into the safety officer. The safety officer was driven across the deck, his arms pumping for balance. He grabbed at the nearest thing, which happened to be the deputy cruiser commander. The preset clock reached firing time. The valve slid shut and the takeoff bell reverberated through the ship. And so it happened that the spacemen of the SCN Scorpius turned their valves, threw their controls, and disengaged their boron control rods, and the great cruiser flashed into space, while the deputy commander and the safety officer were completely tangled with a very flustered and unhappy new Planeteer lieutenant. Sergeant Major Koa and his men had made it before the valve closed. Koa, a 7-foot Hawaiian, took in the situation and said crisply, in a voice all could hear, "I'll bust the bubble of any son of a space sausage who laughs." End of Chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Rip Foster Rides the Gray Planet by Harold Goodwin. Rip Foster Rides the Gray Planet. Chapter 2. Rake That Radiation. The deputy commander and the safety officer got untangled and hurried to their posts, with no more than black looks at Rip. He got to his feet, his face crimson with embarrassment. A fine entrance for a Planeteer officer, especially one on his first orders. Around him, the spacemen were settling in their acceleration seats or snapping belts to safety hooks. From the direction of the stern came a rising roar as methane, heated to a liquid, dropped into the blast tubes, flaming into pure carbon and hydrogen under the terrible heat of the atomic drive. Rip had to lean against the acceleration. Fighting for balance, he picked up his SPAC and made his way to the nine enlisted Planeteers. They had braced against the ship's drive by sitting with backs against bulkheads or by lying flat on the magnesium deck. Sergeant Major Koa was seated against a vertical brace, his brown face wreathed in a grin as he waited for his new officer. Rip looked him over carefully. There was a saying among the Planeteers that an officer was only as good as his senior sergeant. Koa's looks were reassuring. His face was good-humored, but he had a solid jaw and a mouth that could get tough when necessary. Rip wondered a little at his size. Big men usually didn't go into space. They were too subject to space sickness. Koa must be a special case. Rip slid to the floor next to the sergeant major and stuck out his hand. He sensed the strength in Koa's big fist as it closed over his. Koa said,
"Sir, that was the best fleetle I've ever seen an Earthling make. You been on Venus?"
Rip eyed him suspiciously, wondering if the big planeteer was laughing at him. Koa was grinning, but it was a friendly grin.
"What is a fleetle?" Rip demanded. "I've never been on Venus."
"It's the way the waterhole people fight," Koa explained. "They're like a bunch of rubber balls when they get to fighting. They ram each other with their heads."
Rip searched his memory for data on Venus. He couldn't recall any mention of fleetling. Venusians, if his memory was right, had a sort of blowgun as a main weapon. He told Koa so. The sergeant-major nodded.
"That's when they mean business, Lieutenant. Fleetling is more like us fighting with our fists. Sort of a sport. Great Cosmos, the way they dive at each other is something to see."
Rip grinned. "I didn't know I was going to fleetle those officers. It isn't the way I usually enter a cruiser." He hadn't entered many. He added, "I suppose I ought to report to someone."
Koa shook his head. "No use, sir. You can't walk around very well until the ship reaches Brennschluss. Besides, you won't find any space officers who'll talk to you."
Rip stared.
"Why not?"
"Because we're planeteers. They'll give us the treatment. They always do. When the commander of this bucket gets good and ready, he'll send for you. Until then, we might as well take it easy."
He pulled a bar of Venusian true from his pocket.
"Have some. It'll make breathing easier."
The terrific acceleration made breathing a little uncomfortable, but it was not too bad. The chief effect was to make Rip feel as though a ton of invisible feathers were crushing him against the vertical brace. He accepted a bite of the bittersweet vegetable candy and munched thoughtfully. Koa seemed to take it for granted that the spacemen would give them a rough time. He asked, "Aren't there any spacemen who get along with the Special Order squadrons?"
"Never met one."
Koa chewed true.
"And I was on the Icarus when the whole thing started."
Rip looked at him in surprise. Koa didn't seem that old. The bad feeling between spacemen and Special Order squadrons had started about 18 years ago, when the cruiser Icarus had taken the first Planeteers to Mercury. He reviewed the history of the expedition. The spacemen's job had been to land the newly created Special Order squadron on the hot planet. The job of the squadron was to explore it. Somehow confusion developed, and the spacemen, including the officers, later reported that the squadron had instructed them to land on the sun side of Mercury, which would have destroyed the spaceship and its crew, or so they believed at the time. The commanding officer of the squadron denied issuing such an order. He said his instructions were to land as close as possible to the sun side, but not on it. Whatever the truth, and Rip believed the SOS version, of course, the crew of the Icarus mutinied, or tried to. They made the landing on Mercury with squadron guns pointed at their heads. Of course, they found that a sun-side landing wouldn't have hurt the ship. The whole affair was pretty well hushed up, but it produced bad feeling between the Special Order squadrons and the spacemen.
Trigger-happy space bums, the spacemen called them, and much worse besides.
The men of the Special Order squadrons, searching for a handy nickname, had called themselves Planeteers, because most of their work was on the planets. As Major Joe Barris had told the officers of Rip's class, "You might say the spacemen own space, but we Planeteers own everything solid that's found in it." The Planeteers were the specialists in science, exploration, colonization, and fighting. The spacemen carried them back and forth, kept them supplied, and handled their message traffic. The Planeteers did the hard work and the important work, or so they believed. To become a Planeteer, a recruit had to pass rigid intelligence, physical, aptitude, and psychological tests. Fewer than 15 out of each 100 who applied were chosen. Then there were 2 years of hard training on the space platform and the moon before a recruit was finally accepted as a Planeteer private. Out of each 15 who started training, an average of 5 fell by the wayside. For Planeteer officers, the requirements were even tougher. Only 1 out of each 500 applicants finally received a commission. 6 years of training made them proficient in the techniques of exploration, fighting, rocketeering, and both navigation and astrogation. In addition, each became a full-fledged specialist in one field of science. Rip's specialty was astrophysics. Sergeant Major Koa continued,
"That business on the Icarus started the war, but both sides have been feeding it ever since. I have to admit that we Planeteers lorded over the spacemen like we were old man Cosmos himself. So they get back at us with dirty little tricks while we're on their ships. We command on the planets, but they command in space. And they sure get a great big nuclear charge out of commanding us to do the dirty work."
"We'll take whatever they hand us," Rip assured him, "and pretend we like it fine." He gestured at the other Planeteers. "Tell me about the men, Koa."
"They're a fine bunch, sir. I hand-picked them myself. The one with the white hair is Corporal Nels Peterson. He's a Swede. I served with him at Marsport, and he's a real rough space spickaroo in a fight. The other corporal is little Paulo Santos. He's a Filipino and the best snapper-boat gunner you ever saw."
He pointed out the 6 privates. Kemp and Doust were Americans. Bradshaw was an Englishman, Trudeau a Frenchman, Domenico an Italian, and Nunez a Brazilian. Rip liked their looks. They were as relaxed as acceleration would allow, but you got the impression that they would leap into action in a microsecond if the word were given. He couldn't imagine what kind of assignment was waiting, but he was satisfied with his Planeteers. They looked capable of anything. He made himself as comfortable as possible and encouraged Koa to talk about his service in the Special Order squadrons. Koa had plenty to tell, and he talked interestingly. Rip learned that the tall Hawaiian had been to every planet in the system, had fought the Venusians on the Central Desert, and had mined nuclite with SOS-1 on Mercury. He also found that Koa was one of the 17 pure-blooded Hawaiians left. During the 3 hours that acceleration kept them from moving around the ship, Rip got a new view of space and of service with the SOS. It was the view of a Planeteer who had spent years around the solar system.
"I'm glad they assigned you to me," Rip told Koa frankly. "This is my first job, and I'll be pretty green, no matter what it is. I'll depend on you for a lot of things."
To his surprise, Koa thrust out his hand.
"Shake, Lieutenant."
His grin showed strong white teeth.
"You're the first junior officer I ever met who admitted he didn't know everything about everything. You can depend on me, sir. I won't steer you into any meteor swarms."
Koa had half turned to shake hands. Suddenly he spun on around, his head banging against the deck. Rip felt a surge of loosened muscles that had been braced against acceleration. At the same time, silence flooded in on them with an almost physical shock. He murmured, "Brennschluss," and the murmur was like a trumpet blast. The Scorpius had reached velocity, and the nuclear drive had cut out. From terrific acceleration they had dropped to zero. The ship was making high speed, but velocity cannot be felt. For the moment the men were weightless. A nearby spaceman had heard Rip's comment. He spoke in an undertone to the man nearest. His voice was pitched low enough that Rip couldn't object officially, but loud and clear enough to be heard by everyone.
"Get this, gang. The Planeteer officer knows what Brennschluss is. He doesn't look old enough to know which end his bubble goes on."
Rip started to his feet, but Koa's hand on his arm restrained him. With a violent kick, the big sergeant major shot through the air. His line of flight took him past the spaceman, and somehow their arms got linked. The spaceman was jerked from his post, and the two came to a stop against the ceiling. Koa's voice echoed through the ship.
"Sorry, I'm not used to no weight. Didn't mean to grab you. Here, I'll help you back to your post."
He whirled the helpless spaceman like a bag of feathers and slung him through the air. The force of the action only flattened Koa against the ceiling, but the hapless spaceman shot forward head first and landed with a clang against the bulkhead. He didn't hit hard enough to break any bones, but he would carry a bump on his head for a day or two. Koa's voice floated after him.
"Great Cosmos! I sure am sorry, spaceman. I guess I don't know my own strength."
He kicked away from the ceiling, landing accurately at Rip's side. He added in a hard voice all could hear,
"They sure are a nice gang, these spacemen. They'd never say anything about Planeteers."
No spaceman answered, but Koa's meaning was clear. No spaceman had better say anything about the Planeteers. Rip saw that the deputy commander and the safety officer had appeared not to notice the incident. Technically, there was no reason for an officer to take action. It had all been an accident. He smiled. There was a lot he had to learn about dealing with spacemen, a lot Koa evidently knew very well indeed. Suddenly he began to feel weight. The ship was going into rotation. The feeling increased until he felt normally heavy again. There was no other sensation, even though the space cruiser was now spinning on its axis through space at unaltered speed. The centrifugal force produced by the spinning gave them an artificial gravity. Now that he thought about it, Brenschluss had come pretty early. The trip apparently was going to be a short one. Brenschluss. Funny, he thought, how words stay on in a language even after their original meaning is changed. Brenschluss was German for burn out. It was rocket talk, and it meant the moment when all the fuel in a rocket burned out. It had come into common use because the English burnout could also mean that the engine itself had burned out. The German word meant only the one thing. Now, in nuclear drive ships, the same word was used for the moment when power was cut off. Words interested him. He started to mention it to Koa just as the telescreen lit up. An officer's face appeared.
"Send that Planeteer officer to the commander," the voice said. "Tell him to show an exhaust."
Rip called instantly to the safety officer.
"Where's his office?"
The safety officer motioned to a spaceman.
"Show him, Nelson."
Rip followed the spaceman through a maze of passages, growing more weightless with each step. The closer to the center of the ship they went, the less he weighed. He was drawing himself along by plastic pull cords when they finally reached the door marked Commander. The spaceman left without a word or a salute. Rip pushed the lock bar and pulled himself in by grabbing the door frame. He couldn't help thinking it was a rather undignified way to make an entrance. Seated in an acceleration chair, a safety belt across his middle, was Space Commander Kevin O'Brien, an Irishman out of Dublin. He was short, as compact as a Dido rocket, and obviously unfriendly. He had a mathematically square jaw, a lopsided nose, green eyes, and sandy hair. He spoke with a pronounced Irish brogue. Rip started to announce his name, rank, and the fact that he was reporting as ordered. Commander O'Brien brushed his words aside and stated flatly,
"You're a Planeteer. I don't like Planeteers."
Rip didn't know what to say, so he kept still, but sharp anger was rising inside of him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.